This week we're discussing the resurrection factor of fiction. Did Jesus rise from the dead, as the New Testament authors maintain? So you may have heard of Richard Dawkins, who is, of course, widely regarded as one of the greatest New Testament scholars in the world today. Not quite. He's a famous Oxford University zoologist and famous critic of religion. He's written a number of books against religion, in particular his popular 2006 book, The God Delusion. And in The God Delusion, he says, when pressed, many educated Christians today are too loyal to deny the virgin birth and the resurrection, but it embarrasses them because their rational minds know it is absurd, so they would much rather not be asked. So the resurrection, why is important? Well, the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 17, speaking in Athens, says, in the past God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. The resurrection is also, we're told, important by the Apostle Paul in his first epistle to the Corinthian church in chapter 15. He says, if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. So that's his first epistle to the Corinthian church. And the resurrection thus stands as one of the cornerstones, one of the key pieces of the Christian worldview. If Christ is not raised, then Christianity is false. On the other hand, if it can be demonstrated that God exists and that he has revealed himself in the person of Christ, and that Christ, that God has vindicated the messianic credentials and the radical divine self claims of Jesus of Nazareth, then Christianity is true, and the rest is just working out the details, as it were. So the resurrection of Jesus Christ is of fundamental importance to evaluating the question of whether Christianity is, in fact, true. So how do we reason about this issue? So there are two things we need to do. First of all, we need to investigate the facts that are to be explained, and then we need to work out what is the best explanation for those facts. And in doing so, we need to evaluate counterclaims, to evaluate and establish what is most causally sufficient to explain the facts in question, what possesses the most explanatory power, the most explanatory scope, and the most plausibility as an explanation. So the crucifixion of Jesus, just to give some of the background before pursuing the question of the resurrection, the fact that Jesus was killed by crucifixion outside the walls of Jerusalem by the Roman authorities is a fact granted unanimously and universally by contemporary New Testament critics. E.P. Saunders, who is a Jewish scholar, lists this as one of the most almost indisputable facts about Jesus' life. And you can look at many other scholars, Bart D. Ehrman, who's no friend of Christianity, and then other famous New Testament scholars, Gerd Lederman and so on, and they all universally attest to the fact that Jesus, in fact, was killed by crucifixion. And there's a number of good reasons to think that. For example, we have an early Christian creed quoted in 1 Corinthians 15, which mentions the crucifixion. We have Philippians 2, the Carmen Christi, which is also likely to be a quotation on the part of Paul of an earlier, probably a Christian hymn, which mentions the crucifixion. And we also have the Premarchian Passion material. We have John, which is independent of the Synoptics, which mentions the crucifixion. We have even secular sources, albeit secondary sources, like Cornelius Tacitus and the Annals of Imperial Rome, who mentions the crucifixion by Christ under Pontius Pilate. We have Flavius Josephus in the Flavonian Testimonium passage in the Antiquities of the Jews. He mentions the crucifixion of Jesus. It also fulfills the criterion of embarrassment, because the crucifixion became an item of mockery towards the Christians on the part of both the Romans and the Jews. The Romans mocked the Christians for the belief in a crucified Messiah. In fact, there's graffiti in Rome where a man is depicted as beholding and kneeling before a crucified donkey, and the caption is "Alexandros worships his god." And so the Romans were mocking the Christians for the belief in a crucified Messiah, and even the Jews were mocking the Christians for a belief in a crucified Messiah. After all, according to Jewish law, in Deuteronomy 21:23, he who is killed by being hung on a tree is under God's curse. He's rendered literally a heretic. And so it's no surprise then that in the second century, just a martyr in his dialogue with his famous dialogue with the Jewish rabbi Trypho. Trypho says to Justin the Martyr, in response to Justin the Martyr's argumentation from the scriptures that Christ is the Messiah, "These and such scriptures, sir, compel us to wait for he who is Son of Man shall receive from the Ancient of Days the everlasting kingdom. But this so-called Christ of yours was dishonorable and inglorious, so much so that the last curse contained in the law of God fell on him, for he was crucified." And so we have very good reason to trust that Jesus was in fact killed by crucifixion. There's very, very good evidence for that fact. And the fact that the earliest proclamation of the resurrection and the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus was in Jerusalem, which was where Christ was purportedly crucified. And it seems unlikely that does not fit within the view that Jesus wasn't crucified. The Quran, of course, claims that Jesus wasn't crucified in Surah 4, verse 157, which is one reason why I think that we ought to reject Islam, of many reasons. So let's talk about the burial of Jesus. So the burial of Jesus, it's widely recognized that after his death, he was buried in a nearby tomb. Now, according to Josephus against Apion, Jewish law required burial even for foreigners and for executed transgressors. And so it's immediately plausible that he was indeed buried in this way, and has a high prior probability, even before you consider the actual evidence for the burial narratives. Now, the account of Jesus' burial in a tomb by Joseph of Arimathea is part of Mark's early source material for the Passion story, which also supports the historicity of this account because it's in such early material. Paul also in 1 Corinthians 15, 3-5 quotes, as I mentioned, an old Christian tradition that he received from the disciples. And this creedal statement refers to Jesus' burial. Notice also the parallel between 1 Corinthians 15, 3-5 and Acts 13, 28-31. So the question, of course, becomes, well, in 1 Corinthians 15, are we talking about the same burial narrative as the burial by Joseph of Arimathea in a tomb as recorded and recounted in the Gospels? Well, in Acts 13, notice the very close parallel between that and the creed quoted by Paul in 1 Corinthians 15. We read in Acts, quote, "And though they found him, no guilt worthy of death, they asked Pilate to have him executed. And when they had carried out all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead, and for many days he appeared to those who had come up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are now his witnesses to the people." And so it seems that in 1 Corinthians 15, it is because of the very strong similarity in structure between this passage in Acts 13 and this passage in 1 Corinthians 15, it suggests that we're talking about the same event. And that these traditions come from a common source. There's further independent testimony to Jesus' burial by Joseph. It is found in the sources behind Matthew and Luke, or the Matthew and Lukean special sources, M and L, and also the Gospel of John. The differences between Mark's account and those of Matthew and Luke suggest that the latter had sources other than Mark alone. John's Gospel is independent of the Synoptics and reports the burial of Jesus in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea as well. So you have some independent attestation there too. And you also have the early apostolic sermons recorded in the Book of Acts, which make mention of Jesus' burial in a tomb. And thus we have at least four independent sources for Jesus' burial, some of which are very early. For example, the 1 Corinthians 15 passage is early. And the pre-Markian Passion material is early. It seems unlikely that the early church would have invented the story of Jesus' burial by Joseph of Arimathea, given that Joseph of Arimathea was a member of the Jewish Sanhedrin who had condemned Jesus to the cross. And so it seems unlikely that they would have falsely attributed this act of giving Jesus a decent burial by, you know, there was an understandable feeling of resentment towards the Jewish Sanhedrin. So it seems an unlikely invention. So it fulfills the criterion of embarrassment as well as the criterion of multiple attestation and the criterion of early attestation. So you have very good reasons to trust the burial narrative concerning Jesus. But the question that we really want to know is, well, what happens next? So after Jesus died and was buried, then we have four competing hypotheses or explanations for what might have happened. We have one, his immediate followers did not claim he rose again. The Gospels were later myths, and we'll call this the myth hypothesis. Or his followers were deceived into thinking that he rose again. We can call this the hallucination hypothesis. Or third, the followers deceived others into thinking that he rose again. We'll call this the conspiracy hypothesis. And finally, the hypothesis that he did in fact rise again, and we can call this the resurrection hypothesis. So let me just outline the case that I'm going to present in this very short overview. There's places you can go if you want more detail on any of this material and also additional argumentation. You can read Michael Lacona's book, the Resurrection of Jesus, a New Historiographical Approach, or N.T. Wright's book, The Resurrection of the Son of God, or William Lane Craig, The Sun Rises, or those other books by other scholars like Gary Habermas and Michael Lacona and others. But let me just give an overview of some of the evidence. We have the appearances which need to be explained. We have the low status of women. We have the immediate proclamation in Jerusalem. We have the voluntary sufferings of many of the people who purportedly were eyewitnesses to the resurrection. And we have the empty tomb. We can summarize this with the acrostic alive. So let's start by looking at the evidence for the appearances. So numerous people claim to have seen Jesus alive after his death. This is widely recognized by New Testament critics today, and regardless of where they sit on the theological spectrum, even people like Paula Fredrickson or Gerd Ludemann and others who are not Christian scholars, but are nonetheless, I think that the disciples had experiences where they witnessed what they understood to be appearances of the resurrected Christ following his death. Now they might explain that by means of hallucination or some other non-supernatural hypothesis, but these alternative hypotheses need to be evaluated, and we'll come to those. But there's very good evidence that numerous people claim to have seen him alive after his death. There's some of the references from the New Testament that mention those. Now we have the independence of the appearance narration. So the appearance to Peter, for example, is multiply attested by Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 verse 5, and also by Luke in Luke 24:34. And in Luke 24, for example, there's a saying that when the Emmaus people on the road to the believers on the road to Emmaus, when they meet they say that he's appeared to Simon, which is Peter, that's in Luke 24:34. And in 1 Corinthians 15 verse 5, you have the creedal statement quoted by Paul, where he says he appeared to Peter. And so we have the appearance to Peter multiply attested by Luke and by Paul. The appearance to the 12 is multiply attested by Luke in chapter 24. And we have the appearance to the 12 recounted there. We have the appearance to the 12 also independently recounted by John in chapter 20. Now it's interesting actually that Luke telescopes the appearances, because in John actually reports two, one with Thomas absent, one with Thomas present. And whereas in Luke, immediately after the resurrection appearance to the 12, Jesus leads the disciples out, and then he ascends into heaven. Whereas we know that Luke telescopes here, because in Acts chapter 1, also written by Luke, tells us that Jesus stayed and appeared multiple times to the disciples over the course of 40 days. And so he's clearly aware of multiple appearances of Jesus to the disciples and others. And so it's clear that in Luke chapter 24, he actually telescopes the appearances, collapsing them all into one in order to conserve space. And Paul also mentions the appearance of the 12 in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 5. So there you have three independent sources for the appearance to the 12. And we have two independent sources for the appearance to Peter. Now, what are some criteria for unreliable eyewitness testimony? Well, Under the following conditions, eyewitness testimony is typically unreliable, particularly on details. One is that the events happen quickly over a period of seconds or minutes. Another is that the participants are strangers to one another. And third is that there is a weapon present, such as a knife or a gun. You know, if you want to stay alive a bit longer, it's best to focus your attention on where the knife or the gun is pointed. And and in such cases, eyewitness testimony is unreliable. But you'll notice that in the case of the claimed appearances of Jesus of Nazareth, the resurrection appearances are public. Jesus appears to multiple people at once in groups. They are polymodal. And so they involve not just sight, but touch and hearing and conversing. And so they have conversations with Jesus. They observe Jesus eating broiled fish on the seashore. Thomas touches Jesus and so forth. They are also extended across time. It's not simply one event that happens very quickly over a period of seconds or minutes, but actually it is extended over a period of 40 days. So it's not just one brief and confusing episode. Now, there are certain curious features of the resurrection narratives. One is that the resurrection narratives are independent. Unlike the rest of the Gospels, the resurrection narratives actually are independent traditions, although for the most part Matthew and Luke draw upon Mark in the construction of a lot of their narrations. The resurrection narratives actually are independent and actually have quite a variation in the details recounted. There's also an apparent lack of theological reflection. So the gospel writers, in particular Matthew, throughout their gospels, love to say this was done so that the scripture might be fulfilled, and then they quote the scripture. But in the case of the resurrection narratives, there's none of that. And so it suggests that the resurrection actually took them by surprise, and they didn't have the rich arsenal of prophetic texts and references to appeal to. And John's gospel also, interestingly enough, has Jesus walking through closed doors. Now, why is that interesting? Well, John wrote his gospel and his epistles largely as a polemic against Docetic Gnosticism, and that's very clear in the epistles of John. He says, for example, if anyone comes to you claiming that Jesus Christ has not come in the flesh, then he's of the Antichrist, and because the Docetic Gnostics, of course, believed that Christ didn't have a physical form, that he only appeared to be such. But although they affirmed the deity of Christ, they denied the real humanity of Christ. And so John and the resurrection appearances, he's very emphatic about the physicality of the resurrection. He has Thomas touching Jesus. He has Jesus eating broiled fish on the seashore and so on. And yet this same John, fascinatingly, has Jesus walking in and out of closed doors, appearing and disappearing at will. It seems unlikely that John would have invented that, especially in view of his wanting to convince the Docetic Gnostics of Christ's physical nature. So that's fascinating as well. Now, let's talk about the ancient beliefs concerning resurrection. And this is the central theme of a book by the New Testament scholar that you can see pictured to the right, who is currently at the University of St. Andrews in Scotland. And he wrote a book called The Resurrection of the Son of God. And then he looks at the beliefs concerning resurrection in the Jewish world and in the Greco-Roman world. In the Greco-Roman world, the physical world is seen as being defiling and corrupting, and corrupt, while the spirit or soul is considered good. In the Greco-Roman world, the concept of resurrection would be not only plausible, but also very undesirable, because you wouldn't want to be reunited with a physical corpse or physical body. Whereas in Judaism, there's two major sects. There's others as well, but there's two major sects. One is the Pharisees, and one is the Sadducees. Now, the Sadducees, of course, didn't believe in spirits or angels or demons. One might say they were very Sadducee, and they didn't believe in resurrections or an afterlife or anything like that. And they were very sort of materialistic in their practical worldview. And then there were the Pharisees, and they did believe in resurrections, but they But they believe generally in a resurrection at the end of time rather than a sort of first fruits resurrection in the middle of history where one man, namely the Messiah, would be raised from the dead. And so the Christian concept of resurrection seems to be a wholly new innovation in this world. If you read, we often are guilty of a form of what C.S. Lewis called chronological snobbery, where people will look back at the past, look back at the first century Judea and the Greco-Roman world, and will immediately imagine that people were very poised to believe in radical miracle claims, that people believed resurrections very easily. And whereas that's not actually the case at all. I mean, if you read, for example, in the second century, Theophilus of Antioch, who was a Christian apologist, wrote an apology to Autolycus, who was a pagan. And Theophilus says to Autolycus, "Now, as to your saying that the dead are not raised, for he says, show us even one who has been raised from the dead, that seeing we may believe." And there's a passage in Justin Martyr's first apology where he argues for the plausibility of resurrection, and there's also where he says basically that yes, the resurrection might seem implausible to you, but then if you were to be taken from some other world and were to be presented with a drop of human seed, and we shown a picture of a man, and we told that drop of human seed would one day take upon itself the form of that man, it would strain credulity, and yet we know it happens. And so he argued thusly against those that argued that the resurrection was impossible. And so there was certainly a tremendous amount of skepticism in the ancient world concerning the resurrection, although albeit perhaps for different reasons than we have today. Now, you might recognize this man to your right here. This is Tim Keller, who's a very well-known theologian who most famously wrote The Reason for God. And he writes about pagan reasons for skepticism concerning resurrection. In the Greco-Roman world, he writes, this is from The Reason for God, in Greco-Roman thinking, the soul or spirit was skewed, and the physical and material world was weak, corrupt, and defiling. To them, the physical, by definition, was always falling apart, and therefore salvation was conceived as liberation from the body. In this worldview, resurrection was not only impossible, but totally undesirable. No soul, having gotten free from its body, would ever want it back. Even those who believed in reincarnation understood that the return to embodied life meant that the soul was not yet out of its prison. The goal was to get free of the body forever. Once your soul is free of its body, a return to re-embodied life was outlandish, unthinkable, and impossible. And then he writes about the Jewish reasons for skepticism concerning resurrection. Quote, the idea of an individual being resurrected in the middle of history while the rest of the world continued on burdened by sickness, decay, and death was inconceivable. If someone had said to any first century Jew, so-and-so has been resurrected from the dead, the response would be, are you crazy? How could that be? Has disease and death ended? Is true justice established in the world? Has the wolf lain down with the lamb? Ridiculous. The very idea of an individual resurrection would have been as impossible to imagine to a Jew as to a Greek. You might also note, incidentally, that one of the key texts in Second Temple Judaism concerning resurrection is Daniel 12. And Daniel 12 portrays the righteous of Israel shining like stars following the resurrection. Yet no one thinks to portray Jesus as shining like a star in the Gospels. The resurrection in the Christian sense was a radical new innovation. Now, let's talk about the date of the claims. If the Gospels and Acts are substantially historical, then claims of eyewitness encounters with the risen Jesus were the ground of Christian belief from the outset. Now, the early creed in 1 Corinthians 15, 3-7 is independent evidence for the early claim to eyewitness encounters with Jesus. There are certain marks of an early date of the 1 Corinthians 15 creed quoted by Paul. First, and the creed, by the way, says, what I received, I pass on to you as of first importance, that Christ Jesus died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12, and then to James and to 500 of the brothers at the same time. most of whom are still living, but some have fallen asleep, and last of all, he appeared to me also as to one untimely born. And he likely received this creed in Jerusalem upon his meeting with Peter and James, the very people mentioned in that creed is recorded in Galatians. That was only a few years following the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ. There's a number of reasons that mark and suggest its early date. And one is the mnemonic structure of the creed. It's a brief creed, approximately 50 words, designed for memorization. The use of the Aramaic name Cephas, which is an early name for Peter. And then we have the delivery to Paul. Either in Damascus or in Jerusalem shortly after his conversion. He mentions in Galatians having met with Peter and James there. So let's compare the explanations so far. We have the different hypotheses for the appearances. And we have the mythic theory, and of course we've seen that we have multiple attestation. We have very early attestation, and so the mythic theory, I think, is ruled out by those evidences. We have the hallucination theory, but we've seen that the resurrection appearances were polymodal in character, and they were extended across time, and they were to groups of people. And so mass hallucinations seem to me to be extraordinarily improbable. And then we have the conspiracy theory, the idea that the disciples lied about it. But I think that that hypothesis is implausible, as we'll see when we come to look at the fact that many of these early Christians were willing to suffer for their beliefs and for the proclamation of the resurrection of Jesus and for the lordship of Christ, and also the fact that the resurrection seems to be such a radical innovation to Jewish thought, and so the resurrection, there was no need to posit a resurrection. That's not the thing that's going to convince the Jews that Christ is the Messiah. The Jews were not expecting a dying, much less a rising Messiah, but rather a Messiah who would lead a revolt against the Roman authorities and establish a Davidic reign, not suffer the embarrassing and shameful death of a criminal. And so the resurrection is just completely unlike what you would expect. And in any case, the appearances of Jesus following the resurrection would almost certainly not have convinced them that Jesus was risen bodily from the dead, but rather that, if they were simply hallucinating, it seems likely that they would have not concluded that he had a physical resurrection, but rather that he was raised spiritually, or that he was now with God, and he was now in the glorified state in heaven, or something along those lines. But the resurrection hypothesis, I think, best explains that data. So let's look at some other data. Let's talk about the low status of women in first century Judea. So in patriarchal society like ancient Palestine, the testimony of a woman was not really highly regarded. In fact, this is a quotation from Flavius Josephus in his Antiquities of the Jews. And Josephus, of course, was a famous Jewish and Roman court historian. But let not the testimony of women be admitted on account of the levity and boldness of their sex. And also in the Talmud, the Jewish Talmud, any evidence which a woman gives is not valid to offer. And here's also from the Talmud, wherever the Torah accepts the testimony of one witness, it follows the majority of persons so that two women against one man is identical with two men against one woman. But there are some who declare that wherever a competent witness came first, even 100 women are regarded as equal to one witness. But when it is a woman who came first, then two women against one man is like half and half. And so, what's strikingly curious then is that in all four Gospels, the first people at the tomb are women. N.T. Wright, St. Andrews University historian, says, as historians, and this is in his appendix to There Is a God by Anthony Flew, published in 2007, as historians, we are obliged to comment that if these stories had been made up 5 years later, let alone 30, 40, or 50 years later, they would never have had Mary Magdalene in this role. To put Mary there is, from the point of view of Christian apologists, wanting to explain to a skeptical audience that Jesus really did rise from the dead, like shooting themselves in the foot. But to us as historians, this kind of thing is gold dust. The early Christians would never, never have made this up. So the low status of women, well, can the mythic theory explain this? Well, you would expect, First Corinthians 15, the early creed quoted by Paul, doesn't even mention the women witnesses. And so it seems that, by the time that this creed was formulated, it only reports the male witnesses. And so it seems that the appearance traditions are concerning the woman and the discovery of the empty tomb by the woman is probably very early. And so that, I think, counts against the mythic theory. The hallucination theory is not relevant here. And the conspiracy theory, I think that if any conspiracist who was wanting to invent the story of the discovery of the empty tomb would undoubtedly have made male witnesses the key discoverers of the empty tomb, not female witnesses. If you were given the choice, you would pick male over female witnesses. But the fact that they uniformly go with female witnesses suggests that that's really what happened, and that the authors were faithful in passing down what actually happened, regardless of its awkward and embarrassing nature. So, thirdly, I want to talk about the immediate proclamation of the resurrection in Jerusalem. So, every piece of first century evidence indicates that the resurrection was proclaimed in Jerusalem, beginning at Pentecost, just 50 days after Jesus' crucifixion at Passover. Jack Surin writes that the apostles proclaimed the resurrection at Pentecost when Jerusalem expected the spread of the report and endeavored to prevent it, while the eyes of their enemies were yet sparkling with rage and madness, while Calvary was yet dyed with the blood they had spilt there. Do impostors take such measures? Would not they have waited till the fury of the Jews had been appeased, till judges and public offices had been changed, until people had been less attentive to their dispositions? In fact, Cornelius Tacitus in the Annals of Imperial Rome says that the Christian movement was thus checked for the moment by the cross, so that at the cross Christ happened, and then he considered it thus checked for the moment, that it seemed to put an end to the Christian movement. And then suddenly he writes that it broke out again, not only in Judea, the first source of the evil, he writes, but also in Rome, where all things hideous and shameful from every corner of the world find their center or become fashionable. So even Cornelius Tacitus seems to think that it broke out first in Judea. And so that's very consistent with what we read in the Bible. And Cornelius Tacitus, of course, was a member between 56, he lived between 56 and 117 AD, and during his career he was a member of the Roman Senate, and he was also a very well-known historian. So in some places, at some times, the report of a miracle might be allowed to pass without examination, particularly if it was very distant from the place where it is proclaimed. But in the case of the resurrection, proclaimed boldly upon the spot in Jerusalem, the enemies of Christianity had means, motive, and opportunity to discredit the account if they could. If you want to wait until the public offices have changed and so on, then just hang around a few years. Pontius Pilate was only governor of Judea between 26 and 36. The public offices changed fairly rapidly in the ancient world. Now, barely 7 weeks after Jesus' crucifixion, his followers are in the streets at a major Jewish festival proclaiming his resurrection, and thousands of people, almost certainly all devout Jews, are converted. As at J.P. Moreland, the philosopher says, something very big was going on. Now, let's look at our explanations. We have the mythic theory, and of course that can't explain the immediate proclamation in Jerusalem because of the immediacy of the proclamation. Hallucination theory is not relevant. Conspiracy theory, it seems unlikely that that a conspiracist inventing the resurrection story would have had the earliest proclamations concerning the resurrection right in the city where the events purportedly unfolded, right under the noses of both the Romans and the Jews who wanted to put an end to the Christian movement. and had the opportunity and the motivation to be able to do so. I mean, he just produced the corpse from the tomb, and there's many ways in which you could really, I think, refute the earliest Christian proclamation, because Christ's death was public and it was public knowledge. The resurrection hypothesis, on the other hand, perfectly explains this data point, the immediate proclamation in Jerusalem. Fourthly, I wanted to talk about the voluntary sufferings of those who witnessed the resurrection or claim to have witnessed the resurrection. Now, Cornelius Tacitus, at the Annals of Imperial Rome, writes about the great fire that broke out in AD 64 in Rome. And he says that all the lavish gifts of the emperor, even the propitiations of the gods, could not banish the sinister belief that the conflagrations were the result of an order. Consequently, to get rid of the report, Nero fastened the guilt and subjected them with exquisite tortures, a class of people hated for their abominations, called Christians by the populace. Christus, from whom the name had its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius at the hands of one of our procurators, Pontius Pilatus, and the most mischievous superstition, thus checked for the moment, again broke out not only in Judea, the first source of the evil, but also in Rome, where all things hideous and shame from every corner of the world find their center and become fashionable. Accordingly, an arrest was first made of all who pleaded guilty, then upon their information an arrest was made, an immense multitude was convicted, not so much for the sin of firing the city as of hatred against mankind. Mockery of every sort was added to their deaths, for they were covered with the skins of beasts and torn by dogs and perished, or were nailed to crosses, and he writes about how they were set alight to provide light in Nero's garden, and Nero would stand in the dress of a charioteer or mingle with the crowd, and even among criminals who deserved exemplary punishment, there arose a feeling of compassion, for it was not for the public good, but to glut one man's cruelty, it seemed, that they were being condemned. So the early Christians faced immense persecution under the Roman emperors. Nero was a particularly fierce one in the 60s AD. He put a lot of Christians to death. And even before the Romans started persecuting Christians, the Jews persecuted Christians. For example, James, the son of Zebedee, died as a martyr, as recounted in the Book of Acts, chapter 12, I believe. He was martyred by stoning. And James, the brother of Jesus, was martyred by the Jews as well. So, what's the significance of martyrdom? Well, what did the New Testament writers have to gain by making up a new religion? Why would they die for a known lie, right? When life or liberty are at stake, multi-party conspiracies invariably break down. And so it seems unlikely that they would have invented, that they would have died for something that they knew was an invention, was a lie, was a deception. People will die for something they think is the truth, but no one will die for something they know is a lie. Now, the martyrdom of Peter and James, the Lord's brother, Jesus' brother, are particularly well attested. Now, Flavius Josephus, in Antiquities of the Jews, he's of course not a Christian historian, he's a Jewish historian, and he mentions the martyrdom of James, and he was stoned, according to Josephus. And we also have a second century Christian historian who tells us that James was martyred for his faith, that he was actually thrown from the Temple Mount, having been asked by the Jews to renounce the Christians, and he did not, and he was thrown from the Temple Mount, and he survived, and so he was stoned and ultimately bludgeoned to death. We also have a Clement of Alexandria is on other source concerning the martyrdom of James. And I like to ask the skeptic, you know, how much would it take to convince you that your own brother, your older brother, was Yahweh of the Old Testament at the point of martyrdom? It takes something pretty radical, and I think a resurrection would explain that. I think it's the most causally efficacious explanation. In fact, 1 Corinthians 15 tells us that he appeared to James. Galatians 1 and the Book of Acts and elsewhere tells us that James was the leader, was a leader in the Jerusalem church. And so this is especially impressive and interesting and curious in view of the evidence that Jesus' own brothers were not believers in him during his lifetime. This is supported by multiple attestation. For example, in John chapter 7, verse 5, we read that not even Jesus' own brothers believed in him. In fact, they taunted him. And in Mark chapter 3, when his family come to take him home, they say that he's out of his mind or he's deranged. And so you've got Mark and John, independent sources, which seem to converge on that same fact. And also in the end of John, in John chapter 19, where Jesus tells the disciple whom Jesus loved, who is John the apostle, to take care of his mother, and he doesn't entrust his mother to the care of one of his own brothers, which suggests that he wanted to entrust his mother to the care of someone who was a believer, which again adds further support to the notion that before the resurrection, James was not a believer in Jesus, but shortly after the resurrection, even according to Acts chapter 1, Jesus' brothers and family seem to be believers, and James even goes so far as to die as a martyr for that belief. Peter also is an interesting example of a martyr for his faith. We have good testimony for that too. The earliest Christian non-biblical source is Clement of Rome's first epistle to the Corinthian church, and he tells us that Peter died as a martyr. He also tells us that Paul died as a martyr, and we also have sources from this. Clement was written in the first century, end of the first century. We also have Origen, who tells us that he was crucified upside down at his own request. We also have, and you can see that pictured in the background there in the slide. We also have Tertullian, who tells us about Peter's crucifixion. We also have the anticipation of Peter's death by martyrdom in John 21, when Jesus goes so far as to predict Peter's death. And if John was written towards the end of the first century, as most scholars maintain, and Peter probably died in the 60s AD, it seems unlikely that John would have attributed that prophecy to Jesus had it not actually happened in that way. And so we have very good sources concerning the martyrdom of Peter. And Peter, remember, denied the Lord three times to save his own skin, and that seems to be an unlikely invention, because Peter is one of the big names in the early church. Why are you going to embarrass one of the leaders of the Christian movement by saying that he denied the Lord three times to save his own skin? And yet, Peter, according to testimony outside the Bible, and anticipated and implied in John 21, went to his death as a martyr. So you have very good reason to understand Peter to at least be sincere in his proclamation of the post-resurrection appearance to him. And we also have the sources in Luke 24 and in 1 Corinthians 15, which attest to the appearance to the Apostle Peter. Now, let me quote from Antonin Scalia, who has been on the news a lot recently with his passing. He says, and I quote, "It is not irrational to accept the testimony of eyewitnesses who had nothing to gain. The worldly wise do not believe in the resurrection of the dead. So everything from Easter morning to the ascension had to be made up by the grovelling enthusiasts as part of their plan to get themselves martyred." So again, let's look at our explanations. Well, the mythic theory can hardly explain this. The hallucination theory, again, is hardly relevant. The conspiracy theory, again, multi-party conspiracies when life or liberty are at stake can rarely break down. So that hypothesis doesn't explain it. But the resurrection hypothesis, again, explains that better than any of the competing contenders. Now, finally, and before we take questions, I want to look at the empty tomb. Most scholars, not just conservative Christian scholars, accept that the tomb was found empty on Sunday morning. Now, according to Gary Habermas's estimates, it's approximately 75% of critical scholars. This is partly because the story of the empty tomb is early and multiply attested, and it's also partly because of the criterion of embarrassment and the fact that the tomb was discovered empty by women, as we already discussed. Matthew gives us an account of the decision by the Jewish leaders to spin the story by saying that the disciples stole the body. this isn't just reported by Matthew 27, but is also found in Justin Martyr's dialogue with Trypho, written in the middle of the 2nd century, where he points out that the Jews are still at that time sending people from city to city, spreading that story. And is also found in the Talmud of Yeshu, a medieval collection of early Jewish writings. And this is a tacit confession that the Jews could not find the body. And so again, it suggests that the tomb was indeed found empty. There's also the Nazareth inscription, imperial proclamation against grave robbing, dated AD 41, and they're prescribing the death penalty for those who rob graves. And this inscription dovetails with Claudius's troubles. We read of in Suetonius, his life of Claudius, where he had trouble with the Jews in Rome, and it says that that he banished the Jews from Rome at the instigation of one Christus. And so it dovetails with that. So to just look at our contending hypotheses, for the empty tomb, the mythic theory doesn't really explain that, because the testimony of women finding the empty tomb, the fact that the Jews sought an explanation for the empty tomb, the fact that it was proclaimed early in Jerusalem again, the empty tomb is suggested by that. We also have multiple independent sources, so I think the mythic theory is really implausible. The hallucination theory, again, I think is implausible too, unless, I mean one can hardly hallucinate an empty tomb. And also the hallucination theory doesn't explain, if you're saying that the hallucination theory explains the appearances, it doesn't also explain the empty tomb. And so the resurrection has greater explanatory scope than the hallucination hypothesis. It also doesn't, the conspiracy theory also doesn't explain the empty tomb, because if you're inventing, having a conspiracy, you'd be like more likely to invent male witnesses rather than female witnesses to the empty tomb, and in light of the other evidence that we've discussed for the empty tomb, I think that the conspiracy theory is also implausible. The resurrection hypothesis does explain the data, however, and the resurrection hypothesis, thus, I think, and quite, I think we've got a good, powerful argument that the resurrection hypothesis has the greatest explanatory power, has the greatest explanatory scope. And it also has the greatest plausibility, because the cross and resurrection of Christ is the culmination of the Jewish scriptures. And so that significantly raises the prior probability. We know that we have good reason to think that God exists from the scientific apologetics, from natural theology and so forth. We have good reason to think that God had plausible motivation for raising Jesus from the dead. And so I would argue that the resurrection has the greatest plausibility as well as the greatest explanatory power and explanatory scope. And so it's a hypothesis that we should prefer. Now, so in summary then, in conclusion, I give the explanation that the angel gave in Mark 16:6. Do not be alarmed. You see, Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, he has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. So for further reading, if you guys want to read some more books, some books on this to get some more arguments and some more detail on the material that we've gone over, I recommend William Lane Craig, The Sun Rises, or this popular level book by Habermas and Lacona, The Case for the Resurrection of Jesus, which lays out the minimal facts approach to the resurrection, basically arguing for the resurrection on the basis of evidences which match two criteria: one, that they're well supported, and two, that they're agreed upon by the vast majority of New Testament critics, regardless of where they stand on the theological spectrum. There's another popular level book, The Case for Christ by Lee Strobel, or The Case for the Real Jesus by Lee Strobel. A scholarly work by Michael Lacuna, published a few years ago, The Resurrection of Jesus, a New Historiographical Approach, where he makes a really powerful cumulative argument for the historicity of the post-resurrection appearances, arguing that the resurrection is indeed the best explanation. N.T. Wright, The Resurrection of the Son of God, where he focuses on one argument in particular, the argument that the resurrection represents an innovation to both Jewish and Greco-Roman thought. And then another book, a popular level book, is Charles Foster, The Jesus Inquest, which is on the resurrection too. Or another popular level book by J. Warner Wallace, Alive, where he basically presents also the case for the resurrection at a very accessible level. So finally, I'm going to take some questions. I can put Mark in charge so he can control who has the opportunity to ask questions. If you want to ask questions, by the way, you can raise your hand And Mark will promote you to panelists so you can ask your question or make a comment or disagree with me.
All right, let's see. We have a hand up, so let me promote him to panelist.
You have to unmute him, by the way.
Hey.
There you are.
Hey. Sorry. Cool. Yeah, I have great presentation that agree with so much of what's said there. I have a couple of questions about some of the details in those kind of stuff. I'd add kind of anyone watching other good books to kind of read. A View of the Evidences of Christianity by William Paley is brilliant. Also on an academic level, I recommend the chapter in the Blackwell Companion to Natural Theology by Tim McGrew and Lydia McGrew, which is fantastic. So a couple of questions. One is, with all this kind of NT Wright stuff about resurrection, that resurrection is a kind of a new innovation, that kind of stuff, what does that then cause you to do with the bit where Herod says, is Jesus not John the Baptist raised from the dead? And what does it cause you to do with Matthew 27?
Okay, so Matthew 27, I presume you're referring to the accounts of the saints rising. Right. And going to Jerusalem and appearing to many people. I mean, scholars are divided on how to interpret that. Some scholars see this as plausibly a case of apocalyptic imagery. Others see it as literal. And I personally don't hold a firm view on that, although I'm inclined to see it as probably literal. I don't think it's problematic to say that the saints actually did literally rise and go into.
Right. I'm the same.
Yeah. So I don't necessarily see that as problematic at all. The other one you wanted to look at was which
I think it's Mark 6. Let me get it up. It's John the Baptist raised from the Herod sees Jesus. And yeah, I think, let me see if I can find it in a rush. Mark 6. Death of John the Baptist. Yes, when Herod heard about Jesus, he said, John the man I beheaded has come back from the dead. That's Mark 6:16.
Yeah.
So the argument would be that if all the kind of Tim Keller stuff and NT Wright stuff is right, there's this new innovation and that no one could ever believe that anyone else who was ever raised from the dead, and how did they believe it?
Yeah, great question. And also this pertains to the resurrected saints in Matthew 27 as well. Sorry, yeah, I understand your question now.
Right.
Yeah. So, the difference between the resurrection of Jesus and the resurrection of the saints in Matthew 27, and indeed the Jairus's daughter, whom Jesus raised from the dead, and so forth. Right. Is that that these so-called resurrections were really resuscitations rather than resurrections, and they went on to die again. Whereas Jesus, his resurrection was fundamentally different in that he was resurrected in a glorified body, never to die again.
Right.
I mean, even in the Old Testament, you see the concept of resurrection. In the sense of resuscitation, for example, in Ezekiel 37, you have Ezekiel prophesying to the dry bones, the valley of dry bones, and these dry bones become clothed with flesh and become living beings again. But they went on again to die. They didn't live immortally. But Jesus, in contrast, he was resurrected with a glorified body. So the Jews, although they might have had concept of people being raised or resuscitated from the dead, they didn't have this concept of a resurrection with a glorified body prior to the general resurrection at the end of the world.
Right, right, that would be.
Yeah. Okay.
Cool. That's fair. Kind of other questions that I have. One, in terms of persecution of the disciples, So one of the objections you get is, we have records of the persecution of the disciples. We don't ever have we'd need to have a further record of people being able to recount their beliefs. And if they're not able to recount their beliefs, then we can't justify that. Yeah, so it's the idea is that if the people are able to kind of stop, then that makes sense. It's kind of choice that, okay, I can stop now. That it was, I was made up all along, but the argument might be that there's not that opportunity. So what would you say to that?
Great question. So the first thing I'd say is that the disciples were at least willing to die as martyrs, and they were willing to suffer because that was something that was going on at their time. I mean, they proclaimed in Jerusalem, knowing full well that these Jewish Sanhedrin had condemned Jesus to the cross and that they would likely kill them too. That's why, you know, Peter, when he denied the Lord 3 times, he knew that if he was to confess Christ, he would probably get the same fate, and he was terrified of crucifixion. So they knew the consequences of proclaiming the resurrection. The fact that, and also, we know from Stephen's martyrdom, for example. Well, Stephen wasn't a witness necessarily of Christ, but we know from Acts 7 that Stephen, he was preaching and he was martyred. He was preaching the gospel. And then in Acts chapter 12, we have the martyrdom of James, who was killed. It says in verse chapter 12, about that time, Herod the king laid violent hands on him who belonged to the church. He killed James, brother of John, son of Zebedee, with the sword. And when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. And so the reason I think that they were killed is because they were preaching the gospel of Christ, and they were preaching the resurrection. They were preaching, you know, they were denouncing the other pagan gods. And it's interesting that that James, the brother of Jesus, according to Hegesippus in the second century, well, we don't actually have what Hegesippus actually writes. He wrote in the fifth book of his memoirs, but then we have it preserved, that quotation from Eusebius of Caesarea, who then relates to us what Hegesippus said. James was asked to repudiate the Christians, and he didn't, and so he was and he was asked to stand on the Temple Mount. Now, the probable reason why he was asked to stand on the Temple Mount was because they were intimidating him, like, unless you do this, we're going to throw you from the Temple Mount. And he was thrown from the Temple Mount, and then bludgeoned to death, or stoned and bludgeoned to death. So I'd argue that the disciples were at least willing to suffer and die for their faith, and that many of them did suffer and die in that way. In fact, Peter asked to be crucified upside down, according to some sources, because he didn't feel himself worthy to be crucified in the same manner as his Lord. And so the resurrection seems to be a huge part of the motivation for the martyrdom.
Okay, yeah, and that's kind of where I'd go, is that the disciples were willing to do it, and they were very aware of the risks of preaching. I mean, when Jesus is like, take up your cross, and he's like, the world is going to hate you, but you know the risks. And they also, yeah, so I'm with you on that. Yeah, and the other thing, I think you can probably say that hallucination theory deals badly with the persecutions, because I think it's a point that Gary Habermas makes, that he's considering that he's got a paper on the hallucination hypothesis, which is really good. And that one of the points he makes is that when we have hallucinations, that doesn't tend to cause us to believe something long-term. It just tends to cause us to believe that we kind of had a hallucination. So kind of when people have grief hallucinations, for example, they're like, oh, I didn't actually see that person. That, yeah. And so I think there are kind of lots of different things that you can say in response to a hallucination hypothesis, but I think you can also say that it deals badly with persecutions. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Right.
Cool. I think I'm happy there. Yeah, if I have any other thoughts, I'll let you know. So, yep. Cool.
Great.
Cool. See you.
Very good. Very good. All right. Give me a minute here.
Yeah.
It probably will take me a few minutes. I was thinking, Josh, you just something you said. I thought of John 16. You know, John, basically Jesus warned the disciples that they would be kicked out of synagogues, they would be killed, and that the Holy Spirit would bring this back to their remembrance.
Yeah.
So though the resurrection was certainly was unexpected to them, they didn't remember the words of Jesus. After the resurrection, the Holy Spirit brought a lot of this back to their minds. So, Jonathan, to your point about the martyrdom and conspiracy and so forth, it seems that the disciples of Christ would have early on remembered that Jesus had warned them they were going to be killed.
Indeed. Do we have any hands from our audience?
Let's see. I don't see any more hands yet.
If you guys prefer to ask anonymously, or you can submit, or you prefer not to go live with engage your microphone and camera,
yeah,
you can submit questions via the Q&A facility.
Absolutely, yeah. Q&A. We did have one question. Will this be posted for later review? And I just responded that yes, you're recording, and you will be posting this when it's ready.
Correct.
Good. All right. Anyone else? Questions? I'm afraid you were a bit thorough there, Jonathan. You didn't leave us alone.
Yeah, Jonathan. I'll shoot at the question because I think that's ultimately where we need to go to. But what would you say about the necessity of the resurrection? It is something that is not often mentioned in debates or dialogues, but sort of the resurrection is proof that Christ's sacrifice was sort of accepted by the Father, sort of propitiation for us, etc. The resurrection is also sort of necessary for us to sort of to restore us back to the Father, etc. But lot on the necessity for the resurrection. Do you have a few more things that we can scribble down?
On the necessity for the resurrection, why the resurrection is crucial for the gospel, right?
That's correct.
Okay, so the resurrection is God's, for one thing, is God's vindication of Jesus' divine and messianic credentials. And it was also God's vindication that the payment for sins had been accepted. So that's the second thing.
And also,
thirdly, by coming back from the dead and going through death and returning from death, Christ conquered death. And so he went through death and he came out the other side. He conquered death. Christ's death becomes our death, his resurrection becomes our resurrection, his life becomes our life, and Christ lives through us and in us, and when we become believers, we are regenerate, and we die to self, and we live for Christ, and as Paul says in Galatians 2, verse 20, I've been crucified with Christ, it's no longer I that live, but Christ lives in me, in the flesh and life, and I live by faith, and the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. These are I guess the reasons why the resurrection is so central to our proclamation as Christians, that it's not just that Christ died, but that it's God also vindicated him by raising him from the dead bodily, and also Christ upon the resurrection Christ didn't lay aside his physical body when he ascended into heaven either. Christ still has his physical body, and because he has both a human nature and a divine nature, he is able to be our representative, he's able to be our mediator, he's able to be our great high priest. The fact that Christ needed to have both a physical nature and a divine nature, of course, because according to the Old Testament, Psalm 49, no man's life is sufficient to ransom for the life of another. For the verse 8 says of Psalm 49, for the ransom of their life is costly, and can never suffice that he should live on forever and never see the pit. But Christ, being God himself, was able to lay down his life as a ransom because his life did suffice. And he was able to lay down his life in virtue of the fact that he was a man, as well as God. And so he was able to go through death, and God's resurrection of Christ from the dead is a vindication of his divine credentials. So.
Yeah, that's very good, Jonathan. And I also need to add that Dr. Lacona also adds that if the resurrection is a farce, then Scripture and Christianity does not pass the test for the law of non-contradiction, because Jesus says in John 14, verse 1 to 4, that he promises to prepare a place for the disciples. And ultimately, if he did not rise from the dead, he ultimately contradicts himself, and also the claims that he's made is not logically possible and grounded in reality, and therefore Christianity is just simply false. I think Frank Turek also mentioned sort of the understanding that the resurrection ultimately is what essentially separates Christianity from all other religions and cults, because of its essential claim, which is also, you know, sort of another I would say necessity for believing in Christianity or a resurrection specifically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, indeed. And of course, Peter said in Jerusalem in Acts 2:29, "Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that Patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day." And so the resurrection is very unique in that we don't just believe in and worship and trust a Christ who was a great moral leader, but someone who's actually been vindicated by resurrection. And so it suggests that there is something very special about this man. And the resurrection from the dead, the evidence for the resurrection from the dead, really establishes Christianity as true. That we know from scientific evidence and the philosophical arguments that God exists. We have reason to think from the Old Testament scriptures that God had motivation for raising Jesus from the dead. There's good reason to think that. And then he has vindicated his son by the resurrection from the dead, and thus demonstrated to us that Christianity is in fact true, and that it provides a rational warrant and justification for our beliefs.
Amen. Well, very good.
All right, very good. Thank you, Rudolph. Sri has a question, so let me promote him to panelist. Oops. I'm just adding all kinds of people here. Hang on just a minute. Sorry, Sarah, I didn't mean to put you up there. All right, and with Sri, let's see, we will unmute his audio. So, Sri, go ahead.
Go ahead, Sri.
Hello. So, I have one question. That is, how reliable are the traditions here of the martyrdom of the apostles? Yeah.
Great question. For most of the apostles, not very. For most of the apostles, the martyrdom traditions are late, clearly subject to legendary embellishment, and so on. But concerning some of the apostles and acquaintances of Jesus, like Peter the apostle, and James the son of Zebedee, and James the brother of Jesus, we have very good reason to think that they died as martyrs. And you can say that at least the apostles collectively were willing, at the minimum, to die as martyrs, and were willing to suffer for their faith.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I think that's about it.
Okay. Do you have any other questions? Okay.
Thanks. Anyone else?
We have a hand there.
Let's see. Yes, Misty does. So let me bring Misty up.
You too. Unmute Misty.
There you go.
There you are.
Hello. Okay. Really quick question. So obviously other than Jesus, like the Apostle Paul's like absolutely fascinating to me. So what would you say to people who like, okay, what, obviously on the way to Damascus when, you know, Paul is saw Jesus, the men that were with him said that they heard Jesus's voice, but they didn't see anything. So what would you say to people who are like, okay, well, wasn't he hallucinating? No, the Apostle Paul.
Great question. I actually wrote an article on this, which I'll link you in the chat. I'll just give my brief thoughts first, and I'll link you to my article on it for further reading. So there are a number of accounts in the New Testament concerning the conversion of Paul the Apostle. From he was persecuted of the Christians as Saul of Tarsus, and then he converted and becomes the great Apostle Paul. Following an appearance to Jesus, of Jesus to Paul on the road to Damascus. Now, we have good reason to think that he was at least sincere in his belief that Jesus had appeared to him on the road to Damascus. We know this because he was willing to suffer for his beliefs. Read 2 Corinthians 11, for example, talks about the suffering of Paul, or you can read some non-Pauline material such as Acts written by Luke or 1 Clement, section 5, for example. And so we have good reason to think that Paul suffered for his faith, which suggests that he was at least sincere. Now, as and the account in Acts concerning Paul's conversion is in Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 19. And then we also have Paul's own testimony of his conversion. He tells us what he himself understood to have happened. He says in Galatians chapter 1, this is verse 11 and following, "And I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel, for I did not receive it from men, nor was I taught it, but I received it through the revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people, so extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers. But when he had set me apart before I was born, and who called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me, in order that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately consult with anyone, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me, but I went away into Arabia and returned again to Damascus." And so note that in this text, there's no mention made of the locality of Paul's conversion, but you have a casual expression at the end of verse 17, which is brought in for some different purpose, which indicates that it was Damascus. It says that he returned again to Damascus. So he's not saying my conversion happened in Damascus, but this seems to fit very well with the Damascus Road encounter narration in Acts. So you have eyewitness testimony here, which is independent of the testimony of Luke that Luke gives us in the book of Acts. William Paley, of course, notes this in his book on the Epistles of Paul. He calls this the phenomenon of undesignedness, where you have two independent accounts which interlock in a manner unexpected if one is copied from the other or both from a common source. And then in 2 Corinthians 11, 32-33, Paul gives an historical detail also recorded in Acts. He says in verses 32 and 33 of 2 Corinthians 11, "At Damascus, the governor under King Aretas was guarding the city of Damascus in order to seize me, but I was let down in a basket through a window in the wall and escaped his hands." And then in Acts chapter 9, we have the parallel account. When many days had passed, the Jews plotted to kill him, but their plot became known to Saul. They were watching the gates day and night in order to kill him, but his disciples took him by night and let him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a basket. And so he gives us more information, actually, in his epistle of 2 Corinthians than Luke does in his account in Acts. Luke doesn't tell us that it was King Aretas who wished to seize Paul. And so it suggests that Paul is not relying on Acts as a source in order to try and be consistent with Luke. But it also seems that Luke is not relying on Paul's epistle in order to construct a consistent narrative. For example, in the same chapter, the sufferings of Paul that are listed in verses 21 through 29, they're not able to be reconstructed from Acts. They're very they don't follow the Acts chronology. They're independent of that. And also Titus, who is mentioned prominently in this epistle, he's mentioned quite a lot of times in 2 Corinthians, is never mentioned in Acts at all. And yet that's something you would expect to see if the author of Acts was using 2 Corinthians as his source. And the in Acts chapter 9, we read verses 19 through 22, "For some days he was with the disciples at Damascus, and immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogue, saying, 'He is the Son of God.' And all who heard him were amazed and said, 'Is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon his name? And has he not come here for the purpose to bring them bound before the chief priests?' But Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ." So that's consistent with our text in Galatians chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, which both indicate that Paul preached the gospel immediately upon his commissioning, and and we also have the Jews who say, the Christians who say, is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon this name? Which is also which also parallels what Paul tells us himself. And then in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul also gives us another account of what happened. He says, "Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God, but the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain." And so Paul thus claims to have an encounter with the risen Christ and asserts that he was the very last individual to whom Jesus appeared. He says he appeared to him as to one untimely born, which suggests that it was after the ascension into heaven, which is again consistent with Acts. And then the question is, well, okay, so Paul, there's good reason to think from these different eyewitness and independent sources that Paul experienced a vision of Jesus on the road to Damascus. And then the question is, well, what brought him to that conclusion? Well, there's three hypotheses. Either he was telling the truth and Jesus really did appear to him on the road to Damascus, or he was lying and making the story up, or he merely thought that he did, but he simply saw some sort of hallucination. Now, the hypothesis that he was deliberately lying and setting out to deceive people about what he had seen, I think is completely false, is demonstrably false, because he was willing to suffer so much for his the testimony of Christ. For example, in 2 Corinthians 11, he says, "Well, whatever anyone else dares to boast of, I'm speaking of a fool, I also dare to boast of that. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are the offspring of Abraham? So am I. Are the servants of Christ? I am a better one. I am talking like a madman with far greater labors, far more imprisonments, with countless beatings, and often near death. 5 times I received at the hands of the Jews the 40 lashes less one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. And a night and a day I was adrift at sea, on frequent journey, in danger from rivers, danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, and toil and hardships, through many sleepless nights, and hunger and thirst, often without food, and cold and exposure. And apart from other things, there is daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. Who is weak and I am not weak? Who is made to fall and I am not indignant?" And of course, Clement of Rome, writing at the end of the first century, he actually describes Paul as being of his own generation. And so, and there's very good evidence that Clement actually was personally acquainted with Paul. In fact, there's a good argument, I think, that the Clement that Paul mentions in Philippians chapter 4 is the same Clement of Rome, which I can get into if you want me to. But in section 5 of First Clement, writes to the Corinthian church, and Paul, because of jealousy and contention, has become the very type of endurance rewarded. He was in bonds 7 times, he was exiled, he was stoned, he preached in the east and in the west, winning a noble reputation for his faith. He taught righteousness to all the world, and after reaching the furthest limits of the west and bearing the testimony before kings and rulers, he passed out of this world and was received by the holy places. In him we have one of the greatest of all examples of endurance. And then we also have Luke, who in the book of Acts tells about Paul's suffering. So we actually have three independent eyewitness accounts of Paul's suffering. So you have a very good reason to think that Paul suffered for his faith. So that, and he was in fact martyred. So that suggests that Paul was at least sincere. So he really sincerely believes that Jesus had appeared to him on the road to Damascus. Then there's the question, well, maybe he just hallucinated. Aren't there other explanations for how he came to believe that Jesus had appeared to him on the road to Damascus? I think this is unlikely because he was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was a Jew, and he set out to persecute the Christians. He set out to persecute and put to death people who identified with Christ. And so having a vision where he actually hears Christ saying, why are you persecuting me? And actually commissioning him to the role of apostle to become part of the church that he'd once despised, to leave his former way of Judaism and legalism as a Pharisee, to leave that life behind and to go with Christ. I think it seems to me to be unlikely that because he was an enemy of the Christians and not a friend of the Christians, that he would have had such an hallucinatory, visionary experience, which disconfirmed his preconceived beliefs rather than confirmed them. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, makes sense.
Right. I'll post you the link to my article on this topic in the chat window.
Alright, cool. Thank you.
Cool. Jonathan, something else I thought about with Paul, he had more visions than just the one. You know, in 2 Corinthians 12, he talks about knowing a man in Christ who 14 years ago, and when you look at that, that puts it between the time that he had the Damascus vision and when he was in Antioch, and he talks about having other visions. There was also a question that I asked Josh, but I think he's gone. Someone asked a question about the books that he mentioned to you. He mentioned a couple of other books that were good. Did you remember what those were?
Go ahead, Riddle.
Yeah, sorry. I asked him on Facebook quickly, and he said the first one is A View of the Evidence of Christianity by William Bailey.
That's right.
I'll just copy that into the... to everyone so they can see that.
That's a really good book, by the way. William Paley, by the way, is probably the most underestimated Christian apologist philosopher of all time.
Yeah, you're right. He's not given a lot of credit.
And he said the other one is Tim McGrew's The Argument from Miracles in the Black Bull Companion to the Natural Theology.
Excellent paper.
Also
good. That was by Tim and his wife, Lydia, right?
Correct. That's correct.
Yeah.
I'll also send that, yeah.
Good. Yeah, these links that you guys put in the chat window is just excellent. I use them a lot to go to before the chat disappears, or you can save your chat as well. All right, anyone else have a question or a comment for Mr. McClatchy? If so, raise your hand or just let me know in chat and I'll be glad to make you a panelist.
Or maybe everyone's just overwhelmed by the evidence and thoroughly.
Yeah. I think Nizam's got a question. I think his hand is up.
Who's that?
Nizam.
His hand isn't up, but I guess he probably
hang on, I'll make you panelist here. Just All right, sir, you are ready to go.
Go ahead, Nizam. Or maybe not. Are there, Nizam?
Looks like his camera may have frozen.
No, it's not frozen. It's just pointing up the way.
Okay.
But
I've unmuted his microphone. Yeah,
maybe he doesn't have a question. But
okay.
I thought he might, because he's a thoughtful Muslim. So.
All right. Anyone else? Jonathan, can you think of anyone who doesn't believe in the resurrection who has presented a strong case against the resurrection?
Okay. And Nizam says, "Hi, sorry, my connection broke, but I did not have a question." Okay. So someone that's not a Christian but has presented and has presented a strong case against the resurrection. A strong case against the resurrection. No. Cases against the resurrection, yes. Personally, I don't actually find those that have argued against the resurrection, I don't find their, most people will grant the minimal facts. They'll grant the appearances. They'll grant the conversion of James, the skeptic. They'll grant the conversion of Paul. As the result of his Damascus Road experience, which he interpreted as an appearance of Christ. They'll grant at least about three quarters of them will grant the empty tomb. They'll grant the burial. They'll grant the appearances. These facts are unanimously almost granted by New Testament critics today. Now the question that is in dispute is the best explanation for those facts, and probably the best critique. Bart Ehrman makes a critique of the resurrection in that he argues that an historian can never infer a miracle as the best or most probable explanation of an event. Because a miracle is always the least probable explanation. So no matter how improbable alternative explanations are, they're still going to be more probable than the resurrection. And this is, I think, based on a flawed notion of the nature of prior probability. I personally think that the prior probability of the resurrection is not at all low, certainly not astronomically low, especially in view of the fact that we have good reason independently to think that God exists. And we have good reason independently to think that God had motivation for raising Jesus from the dead, especially in view of the way that the Jewish scriptures culminate in the cross and resurrection of Christ and point towards the Messiah and who was to suffer and be raised from the dead. So I think that, and also Jesus in fact claimed that the resurrection from the dead would be the vindication of his divine credentials. So I would argue in light of those factors, the resurrection needs to be a plausible candidate on the table. Now I know in the Blackwell Companion chapter, which has been mentioned a few times tonight, the McGrews, Tim and Lydia McGrew, present an argument that the prior probability of the resurrection has to be very, very low in order to mitigate against the positive evidence for the resurrection of Jesus. So that's probably, the methodological critique is probably the best one. I've never seen an objection to the resurrection, which I found to really show my confidence in the evidence. The evidence seems to me to be very, very secure and strong.
Yeah, Jonathan, can I add something? I think if you look at in the last few years, somebody that has brought up sort of a case against the resurrection of Jesus, Dr. Mark Lacona did a debate with Greg Cavan. He's Robert Greg Cavan of, I think he's Cyprus University or something like that. And in his debate with Dr. Lacona, he basically took on defenders like Dr. McGrew, Swinburne, Dr. William Lane Craig, Habermas, Lacona as well, et cetera, et cetera, and even Josh McDowell and Lee Struble, those guys. And I'll send you a link to his sort of PDF slides, because I find that a lot of Muslim apologists in South Africa have basically picked up on sort of his he's got three main contentions. The first one is basically obviously the anti-supernatural sort of view on the resurrection, where sort of the resurrection theory, according to him, has sort of virtually zero sort of credibility, supernaturally or naturally rather. The second one he goes for then is he goes into the explanation of the empty tomb and the post-mortem appearances of Jesus. He sort of tries to show that it's sort of completely devoid of explanatory power and scope, and he makes a case for that. And then his third one is that he's basically an alternative theory for the resurrection itself. Now that obviously in itself sort of places a lot of responsibility on his shoulders to prove that. But I would say that he's definitely in a line of thought that I would say is essentially the newest sort of strand or view that have been raised against, like you said, natural theology, Dr. McGrew, William Lane Craig, Habermas, Lacona, Geisler, et cetera, et cetera. But what I will do is I'll send you the link to his PDF sort of slides from his presentation, and also the link just to the actual debate that he did with Dr. Lacona, which is really worth a look, just to sort of educate yourself or everybody else that would be interested in that, for that matter, on that.
Great.
Very good. Thank you, Rudolph. Anyone else have a question for Jonathan or a comment to share with us? Got some good links going on in the chat too. That's very helpful.
Indeed.
Let's see, someone just raised their hand, but I missed. Okay. Who's that?
Promote Sarah to panelist.
Sarah, be glad to. Hang on just a minute, Sarah. All right, Sarah, you are unmuted.
Hello, sorry for my shiny forehead. Jonathan, could you quote on, or could you comment on the Muslim position on the resurrection, i.e. Not resurrection from death, but just being raised up?
Sure. So the Quran in Surah 157 and 158, verse 157 denies that Christ was crucified. There's 40 words in the Arabic. It says, in reference to the Jews, they said in boast, "We slew the Messiah, Jesus, the Son of Mary, the Messenger of Allah." But they did not kill him, nor were they crucified, but they were deluded by resemblance. And those who differ in the matter are surely in doubt about it, but it is certain they did not kill him. And then verse 158 says, "But Allah raised him towards himself." And so the classical interpretation is that someone was made to resemble Jesus, which is what it means by they were deluded by resemblance, and someone was put on the cross in Jesus' stead, and then Jesus was ascended into heaven, and so was delivered from death in that way, rather than being resurrected. So that's the Muslim view on that.
Okay, and I mean, what do you think is their strongest? I mean, even today I was speaking to a Muslim about this and other issues. And they're going to the Sirah because there's no information really about what happened in the Quran or in the Hadith. And Nizam, you may want to comment on this. I'm really struggling to find why they cannot, apart from just believing that the Quran is the word of Allah, why it's so difficult for them to see the evidences, to see for that Jesus died in the first place, and then that we believe resurrection from the dead.
So Muslims are forced, by virtue of what the Quran says about the crucifixion, to reject the evidence throughout the evidence for the crucifixion. There's tremendous evidence for the crucifixion. You have eyewitness testimony, you have independent testimony, you have early testimony, you have embarrassing testimony, like everything converges on the crucifixion. There's just so much evidence for it. You have adverse testimony from likes of Josephus and Tacitus. There's just so much good evidence for the crucifixion. Now, the way that Muslims typically try and get around it, at least most Muslims, not every Muslim, most Muslims try to get around it by saying that that someone was made to look like Jesus and put on the cross by mistake. And so basically it makes Allah into the inventor of Christianity, which they were deluded by resemblance, which parallels what the Quran says of Allah. He's the greatest of deceivers, right? So it makes Allah responsible for the deception that is Christianity if Islam is true. Now my way of responding to that, because it's ad hoc and implausible, yes, but it does explain the data. So if they want to explain the evidence for the crucifixion in that way, then go ahead. But the problem is that it fails at the point of explaining Jesus' predictions concerning the crucifixion and resurrection from the dead. So if Jesus really was a prophet and predicted his impending death and resurrection, then you have a problem. If Jesus didn't in fact die in that way and wasn't in fact raised from the dead. I have a few arguments for that. And one of them is, for example, in John 2:19, or verses 18 and 19 of John chapter 2, the Jews say to Jesus, "What miraculous sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all these things?" And he says, "I will destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days." And he is speaking of his body. And it's only after the resurrection that the Christians remembered what Jesus had said and believed in the resurrection. But the Jews, of course, respond, "And you take this 46 years to build this temple. How then can you say that you will rebuild it in 3 days?" And then you flip over to we don't hear about anything else about this in the Gospels. Sorry, in John. But in the Synoptic Gospels, if you flip over to them, in Mark 14:58 and Matthew 26:61, you have this this occurrence where Jesus is at the trial before the high priest Caiaphas, and the false witnesses accuse him, saying, "We heard this man say, 'I will destroy this man-made temple, and in 3 days I'll build another, but not by human hands.'" Now, Jesus never said that, but you have this later misrepresentation, but no pretext provided in the Synoptics. The independent account in John gives us the pretext, but not the later misrepresentations that's used as an accusation. So that hand-in-glove fit, or that undesigned coincidence, I think suggests the authenticity of that saying. Now, you also have other sayings. For example, you have the Last Supper, and Jesus breaks bread, giving thanks for it, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Mm-hmm. Now, that is fascinating because we have a source not just in the Gospels but also in 1 Corinthians 11, and so you have a primitive tradition, and it's preserved in the pre-Pauline tradition, preserved for us in 1 Corinthians 11 24 through 25, and also in Luke 22 15 through 20. So you also have independent tradition in Mark 14:22-24. Now, the tradition shared by the pre-Pauline source material and Luke is especially apparent in the saying about the cup in verse 25 of 1 Corinthians 11 and in verse 20 of Luke 22, since it appears nearly word for word, and that suggests that Luke and Paul drew on a common tradition independent of Mark. And therefore, the authenticity of that saying is supported by the criteria of early and multiple attestation. And then we also have in Mark 8 verses 31 through 33, and we read, "And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning around and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, 'Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but the things of man.'" So we find here two statements that are unlikely inventions of the early church, given their embarrassing nature. So Peter is reported to have rebuked his master Jesus, and Jesus in turn rebukes his disciple Peter. And Peter, of course, becomes the lead apostle in the post-Easter Jerusalem church. And both of those rebukes are linked to Jesus' prediction of his death and resurrection, since there is no occasion for either rebuke without Jesus' prediction concerning his death and resurrection. And then a second reason to take this text as authentic is that there's a parallel text of Matthew 16 and in Luke 9, which are independent, so that thus we have multiple attestation. And then we also have the criterion of dissimilarity as well, because Jesus uses his self-designation Son of Man, which is not found in other New Testament literature besides the words of Jesus himself. And then you also have the prayer of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, where he's in the garden. And of course, notice when in the context of Christian-Muslim dialogue, Muslims typically say, well, who was Jesus praying to in the Garden of Gethsemane? But there he was actually anticipating his impending death. Jesus prays, you know, let this cup pass from me. It seems to fulfill the criterion of embarrassment. You have various accounts of Jewish martyrs who act, and Christian martyrs who act bravely under circumstances of torture and execution, such as, for example, in 2 Maccabees or in the martyrdom of Polycarp, for example. But Jesus is shown by this account in Mark to be, and Matthew and Luke, to be far less valiant and weaker. And so that could cause embarrassment for the early Christian believers, because the later Christian martyrs, the accounts narrating their deaths are often subject to legendary embellishment, and often are designed to provide encouragement to others who may face similar situations. But the passion narratives show no evidence of this. In fact, Jesus anguishes over his impending treatment and wants to avoid it if at all possible, and it certainly wouldn't inspire those whom he had just told to take up their own cross and follow him if he wanted to be his disciples. And Jesus' request for God to remove the cup from him stands in contrast to the defiant words of the martyrs, and so it seems an unlikely invention by the early church. And there also appears to be independent tradition supporting this Gethsemane prayer. In Hebrews 5, verse 7, we read, quote, in the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. And obviously the author of Hebrews doesn't think that Jesus was spared from death, as we know from elsewhere in Hebrews. And so the claim that Jesus' prayer was heard suggests that he ultimately was vindicated, and so you have, I think, good reason to think from those different multiple lines of evidence that Jesus really did predict his impending violent death by crucifixion and his resurrection from the dead, which I think flies in the face of the Muslim view that Jesus was simply substituted. Or, I mean, some Muslim apologists like Shabir Ali will take the view that Jesus simply swooned on the cross, which I think is fraught with problems and difficulties too.
I am that Hebrews quote, that he offered up prayers and his prayers was accepted. I've heard from a Muslim friend that prayer was that the cup be removed away from him, the cup of crucifixion, and that's the prayer that was accepted. And so, yeah, I just feel, and Nizam weigh in if I'm incorrect, I just feel that there is this issue where very, very clearly Jesus predicts his death and resurrection. He teaches the disciples, like you said, in Matthew 8 and in various places. And half of the Gospels is dedicated to the lead up to the death of Jesus, the crucifixion and the subsequent resurrection, what happens after the resurrection. That's the whole purpose of. That's why we have Christianity, the death and resurrection of Christ. Without it, there would be no Christianity whatsoever. Exactly. So I'm still at a loss why Muslims find it so difficult. I know that their hands are tied by the Quran, but just critical thinking of history, I, I'm I'm just trying to find the best way to communicate these things.
Yeah. Yeah. Communication is always.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you, Sarah. Let's see, we have Glenda has a couple of questions as well.
Okay.
All right, Glenda, you can speak with us.
Excellent. So just as Sarah was talking about Muslims, that brought Jews to my mind. Do Jewish people still actively fight the resurrection to this day, like the 21st century Jewish people? Do you know, when we're talking about scholars, are these including them? Do you know anything about that?
Well, actually, I'm debating a Jewish apologist on Tuesday on this topic. So.
How convenient. What, on Tuesday?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Might be working then. Oh. Well,
it's being recorded for Unbelievable on Perma Christian Radio, and then it will air on Easter weekend.
Okay.
And it will be uploaded to my YouTube channel after it's aired. Okay. Jews typically will reject the resurrection of Jesus. Although I did hear William Lane Craig mention that he's heard a Jewish scholar say that he was convinced of the resurrection on historiographical considerations, even though he didn't accept Jesus as the Messiah. But I don't remember who that was, but I remember Bill Craig mentioning that.
Okay. Also, the second question I had was 40 days. This 40 days. So 40 days Jesus after his resurrection appeared to people. So 40 days it rained for Noah, and 40 days Moses was on Mount Sinai, and 40 days Jesus fasted. Coincidence? Or is there something that I don't know about this 40 days?
Yeah, I mean, 40 days certainly is a very symbolic number in scripture. There's a tremendous consistency in scripture in the sense that all of the types and foreshadows and prophecies and so on point towards Christ. And there's also numerical consistency in the way that numbers are often employed. Number 7, for example, and number 40, etc. Number 3. And if one wanted to discount the historicity of that in view of the numerical patterns, I think that undergirding that would be a rejection of the supernatural origins of Christianity and the supernatural origins of scripture. I mean, for example, Barabbas, the one who was set free while Christ went to his execution, his name literally means son of the Father. Coincidence? Christ died on the eve of Passover, right while the Paschal lambs were being slaughtered. Coincidence? You know, Christ died in outside Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem, on one of the mountains in the region of Moriah, namely Mount Calvary, because the region of Moriah, we know from Second Chronicles, I think it's chapter 4, was where Solomon built his temple. So we know that Jerusalem is founded in the region of Moriah, and then we know that Abraham is going to sacrifice Isaac on one of the mountains in the region of Moriah that God would tell him about. So again, coincidence. So there's many coincidences throughout the Bible. Even the name Jesus is significant, because in the book of Zechariah, for example, the one identified as the foreshadow of, quote unquote, my servant, the branch, two messianic titles, is identified by the name of Joshua, which means the same, which is basically equivalent to Jesus or Jehoshua. And his father is called Jehozadak, which means Jehovah is just. Coincidence? So there's many coincidences in scripture, which aren't really coincidences, because we know that God is the author of all of scripture. And so all of history is directed towards the cross and resurrection of Christ. And I think that is, in fact, an independent line of evidence, which in my mind strongly confirms the truth of the Christian worldview.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Glenda.
You're welcome.
Good. All right. Does anyone else like to ask some questions or make comments? Or yeah. Give me practice.
on, Nazim. I'm sure you must have some questions to challenge me on my case for the resurrection. Or my case against the Islamic concept of the cross and resurrection, for that matter.
Zam says he missed your presentation.
Oh, well, you can, you know the general outline of the case. So.
No. Jonathan, do you hear the twin brother theory very often?
No, I don't hear it very often. I have heard it, but I haven't heard it very often. It seems to me to be ad hoc and really clutching at straws, to be quite honest.
Yeah, I agree. I rarely hear it, but every once in a while I'll see it in one of the apologist books. They just mention it, but I really have not heard it much at all. Mm-hmm. It seems very implausible.
Nazim says, what is ad hoc? I'm not sure if he wants to know what ad hoc means. I think he probably knows that, or whether he wants to know what I considered to be ad hoc. I think probably the latter. I mean, for those that don't know in the audience, ad hoc means contrived. What is ad hoc? The twin brother hypothesis, the idea that Jesus' disciples were deceived by a twin brother of Jesus, seems to me to be very ad hoc.
Yeah, and even with, as to me, it's so ludicrous, the idea that a twin brother could have hidden out for all those years and not have been known by anyone else.
Yeah.
I would assume that Mary would certainly have known.
Yeah, you would think that Mary would know.
But none of the other family would have known, and the brother hid out, and Jesus hid him out so that one day he could have his twin brother die in his place. Still doesn't answer the question of the empty tomb.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So again, the it's a cumulative thing. So the resurrection has the greatest explanatory scope and greatest explanatory power and greatest plausibility, and so it is to be taken as the best explanation. Nizam says, is it ad hoc or something that people discovered from reading in the New Testament? You would have to give me an argument, Nizam. If you want, you can be promoted to panelists and see if you can defend the twin brother hypothesis.
Yeah.
And yes, there are people with multiple names, but that doesn't mean that you could. I mean, there's different Judases, there's different Marys, and different Jameses, different Johns. That doesn't mean that you can deceive people into thinking that you're one of the other ones. And it seems, as Mark already alluded to, it seems highly improbable that a twin brother of Jesus would be also happens to be called Jesus, could hide out for so long and never be known by anyone, including his own mother, and then suddenly appear and convince everyone that he was the resurrected Jesus.
Zan, would you like me to make you a panelist so you can talk with Jonathan? You've got some really interesting questions here in the chat. I think it'd be great to hear them from you. The New Testament is, you were pointing out, Jonathan, about the different names. Well, the same names, and yet they were different people. And the New Testament writers are pretty good at saying Judas, not Iscariot, but I think the writers of the Gospels understood that there were going to be some, there was going to be a necessity to point out that it's this Judas and not that Judas, or it's this James and not that Judas.
And that's interesting, actually, because as Richard Bauckham and others have shown, there's a tremendous correlation between the frequencies of names inside the New Testament and the frequencies of names in ossuaries and documentary sources in first century Judea. And what's interesting is that for the list of the disciples, and also this is a pattern which you find throughout the Gospels, there's a remarkable correlation between the prevalence of the name in first century Palestine and the need for a qualifier or a disambiguator to distinguish one, say, Simon from another Simon, and so on. So you have this remarkable correlation, and that's not something, I mean, that's something that has the ring of truth about it, that you have this, that the less frequent names don't get a qualifier because it's as obvious which we're talking about, but the high frequency of names do need qualifiers. And the remarkable correlation between the frequency of names inside and outside the New Testament is remarkable. I think it really evidences the New Testament's historicity.
Yes. Okay. As Am says that he'll hopefully ask some questions next time or another time.
So as to Jesus not being recognized after the resurrection, Mary, for example, thinks him to be the gardener, for example, and we read that the people on the road to Emmaus are kept from recognizing him. But the fact is that they ultimately do recognize him. At first they don't recognize him, and then the scales are removed from their eyes and they do recognize him. So I don't necessarily see that as a important objection.
Yeah, I agree.
And interestingly enough, the sort of the identical twin theory is something that is also sort of deduced from, I think, it's not the Gospel of Thomas. I think it's the Acts of Thomas in the Nag Hammadi Library. There's sort of a mention of Judas's brother or James, where it speaks specifically of, or it's deduced that there's sort of an identical twin referred to in the Gnostic texts. But it's not historical, and obviously it's got a very weak explanatory scope. So, most historians won't even go there. It's that bad, and so definitely not.
Yeah, even when I was an atheist, Methodist, I took a look, as I was taking a look at the evidence, the swoon theory, the twin theory, none of those theories even made much sense to me as an unbeliever, because if this was an historical document, which it was, Gospels are clearly historic narratives, it just didn't make sense that you would have all this crowd and professional Roman soldiers who their job was to day after day after day after day kill people, that they could have somehow missed the fact that this person was not dead.
Yeah, for sure.
It just never made sense to me, even though I didn't really believe in the supernatural. It just historically didn't make sense.
Notice, by the way, that the early Christians, I mean, upon seeing Jesus risen from the dead, or having witnessed the reports from the woman to Jesus having been raised from the dead, they didn't believe it at first. I mean, Luke 24, for example, it says that verse 11, as it was when the woman, in verse 10, now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary, the mother of James, and the other woman with them, who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them as idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what has happened. So they didn't believe the testimony of women, which is consistent with the low status of women argument I made. And they thought that it seemed to them like nonsense, and so because of their Jewish expectations, they weren't expecting a resurrection, and so that's why it took them by surprise. There's no prophetic allusions in the resurrection narratives in the Gospels, because it took them so starkly by surprise. In John's Gospel, it says that they still hadn't realized from Scripture that God had to raise Jesus from the dead.
Another thing that is interesting in John's Gospel, something that I've actually not heard apologists sort of look at, but it's pretty obvious in the text. At the empty tomb in John 20, verse 1, it speaks and it says that it was early and still dark, which is just such a, sort of important point, because it made it quite difficult to see. But what is interesting is that Mary, when she's hearing the voice of Jesus, she suddenly realizes that it is him, and emphatically says and identifies him, which is just astonishing.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point, Rudolph. Yeah.
All right, we're at about the 2-hour mark, so I just wanted to see if anybody else would like to ask any questions or to share comments with Jonathan. This has been very, very good. I liked your presentation. Good questions. It's been a good session.
Indeed.
Yeah, no, fantastic. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks, Jonathan. That was very neatly and well presented. It is something I will definitely look over if I ever have to sort of look at the resurrection and the death of Christ.